Good afternoon and welcome to About Health. I'm your host, Rona Renner, here twice a month with you to explore different concepts of health and well-being. I'm a nurse, parenting coach, author, mother of four, and grandma of five. And today I'm honored to have the dynamic mother and daughter team, Anna LaPay and Frances Moore LaPay, join me to discuss the issues presented in the 50th updated anniversary edition of Diet for a Small Planet. But before I introduce my guests, I just want to thank all of you who are able to donate to the Fall Drive. I want to thank you for your generous support. The drive is over, but we still need your help to reach our goal. So please donate what you can at kpfa.org. Our thank you gifts are still available there, and all donations, big or small, will receive the free digital Storytelling for Social Change audio gift. KPFA is 100% listener supported, so please help us reach the goal by donating at kpfa.org. And I thank you very much. Also, I want to acknowledge that it's Indigenous Peoples Day today, and I know some deep core values of Indigenous ways are to care for the land, care for the waters, care for all beings, and to save our earth. As we speak right now, Native American-led protests are going on in Washington, D.C., the start of 5 days of demonstrations demanding greater action on the climate crisis and climate injustice. May they all be safe. Now to my guests. In the book Diet for a Small Planet, Frances Moore LaPay talks about her shock in discovering the needlessness of hunger and being able to see what is amiss in our world and the power we have to fix it. She says, quote, "There is still hunger. Our diet still makes us sick. Americans throw away more food than ever. Resources and species are disappearing. The climate is in crisis, and food is a major contributor. How can it be that 700 million people go hungry and 1 in 5 children worldwide suffer from malnutrition?" Frances Moore LaPay is the author or co-author of 20 books, including the 3 million copy Diet for a Small Planet, and just published is this book's 50th updated anniversary edition. The Smithsonian's National Museum of American History describes Diet for a Small Planet as one of the most influential political tracts of the times. The recipient of 20 honorary degrees, Frances has been a visiting scholar at MIT and UC Berkeley, and in 1987 received the Right Livelihood Award, which is often called the Alternative Nobel. She's a founding member of the World Future Council and serves on the National Advisory Board of the Union of Concerned Scientists. She's co-founder of 3 national organizations, Oakland-based Food First, the Center for Living Democracy, and Small Planet Institute, co-founded with her daughter, Anna. So Frances Moore LaPay, welcome back to KPFA.
Thank you, thank you. I feel at home, because Anna will know that she was brought up listening to KPFA, so it feels very much we're back home.
Well, first I want to ask you, do you like to be called Frankie or Frances?
Frankie, if you feel comfortable.
I do. I feel very comfortable. That's what I know you as. You know, our paths crossed when your son Anthony was good friends with my oldest son in high school. And Anthony used to stay with us sometimes for overnights when you were on book tours or giving a lecture in different parts of the country. Do you remember that, Frankie?
I don't. I'm embarrassed to say it. But I'll mention it to Anthony.
He will remember it. I mean, he would show up at the house and these guys would have a great time. And I remember one time you left a big, beautiful basket of fruit for me as a thank you. And so we never really spent time together, but our children did.
Yes, and he's that was a documentary filmmaker right now and about to come out with a new series. So watch for that name, Anthony LaPay, How the Rest of Us Die, While the Rest of Us Die is the name of it.
Okay, thank you. We'll definitely look for that.
Great.
You know, I want to start off with you, Frankie, and ask you how you realized in 1969 that you needed to write a small pamphlet challenging the way America ate. You know, you talk about the fact that you weren't a writer, you never had the idea that you'd be doing this, and you started with a pamphlet. What was it that made you realize, you know, this was in your future, you needed to do this work?
Well, I had to, Rona, because the experts were all telling us that our problem was scarcity and we were overwhelming the Earth's capacity to feed us. And when literally sitting just, you know, a few blocks from where you are in the library there, I put two and two together with my dad's slide rule. I kind of added things up and said, wait a minute, there's enough for all of us. And we humans are creating scarcity when there's really plenty. And it was this message of hope. Because if we really were hitting the Earth's limits, that's really scary. But if we are actually creating it, then we can stop creating hunger. We can stop creating the experience of scarcity. So I just felt I had to do something, and I'd never imagined I was a writer. I love to tell college students that I made a D on my first English paper in college. So I did not think I would be a writer.
And yet you had this passion, and you know, you've also said that you wanted to focus people on the idea of power. Say a little bit more about that.
Well, I've come to see that we humans, beyond food, what do we really need? We need a sense of power, that we're not powerless, that we have agency. We also need to feel that our lives have meaning, and that we are connected to others in something meaningful and powerful. And for me, I realized, well, I didn't have that trilogy back then, but I did have this instinct, this intuition, that food was a pathway that we could gain a sense of power, that we're not just victims. I mean, human beings didn't evolve to be just, you know, just followers. We evolved to be creators and be heard. And that's really why I felt like I had to share this message, because we make food choices multiple times a day, and they can be conscious, and they can therefore send out ripples everywhere that are constructive and positive for ourselves and the planet. Or we can do the opposite. The choices we make can be harming us every single day, as food has become more and more a source of disease in the world. So, you know, I just felt like I had to share this sense of possibility that something we do, so ordinary as eating, actually gives us power if we seize it.
And you were drawn to bulgur and beans and tofu, and yet you came from Texas, I believe. You know, how did you? I mean, I know there were books, you know, in the 70s where people were starting to look at vegetarianism. How did you get drawn to those beans?
Well, I first of all, yes, the town I grew up in is nicknamed Cowtown, so it's pretty funny. But I just thought that it was so obvious that we were wasting such vast amounts of agricultural resources and water, et cetera, in putting so much of our resources into livestock that return such a small fraction to us. And since then, I've learned that on average, we put about 80% of agricultural resources, including grazing land, into livestock. But they return only 18% to us in food. So there's tremendous loss there. And in terms of the calories, say, that cattle eat, we get only 3% of those calories in the meat that we eat. So I put it all together in my head and said, wait a minute, this is insanity. You know, I saw my first sort of eating plant-centered diet as just an act of rebel sanity. Hey, I don't want to be part of this insane system, and I can make other choices. And it's been so satisfying to see that awareness growing.
It definitely has, and we'll keep talking about that. Thank you, Frankie. I'm really happy now to introduce your daughter, Anna LePay. She's co-founder of Small Planet Institute, which is she's a national best-selling author, respected advocate for sustainability and justice along the food chain, and an advisor to funders investing in food system transformation. She founded Real Food Media to bring together leading food and farm organizations to produce powerful communication initiatives to inspire, educate, and grow the movement for sustainable food and farming. Her most recent book is Diet for a Hot Planet, The Climate Crisis at the End of Your Fork and What You Can Do About It. She also helped edit the recipe section of the new 50th anniversary edition of Diet for a Small Planet. In more than two decades of organizing, Anna has helped direct millions of dollars to advocate for food justice and sustainability around the country and the world. Her research on food systems has taken her to more than 25 countries and 100 U.S. cities. Anna LePay, welcome back to About Health.
Thanks so much. It's been fun listening to the conversation.
Well, it's so great that you and your mom are talking about this 50th anniversary. And, you know, I was thinking, Anna, that your mom has been both your mother and your mentor. And I was wondering, at what age did you realize that you were drawn to the work she was doing? And what was that like for you?
That's a great question. You know, on some level, I was always drawn into the work, both of my mother and my father. He was a toxicologist and epidemiologist and did really incredible work. So I was always moved by the work they did, and I always had the sense that I wanted to follow in their footsteps in the broad sense, you know, really think about how could I, with my career, do work that was meaningful. My mother talked about that as one of those qualities that we humans seek. So I always knew I wanted to seek out meaningful work, but I didn't really see myself as directly following in her footsteps until I was the age that my mother was when she wrote Diet for a Small Planet, so in my mid-20s. And she and I embarked on a journey to write a book together. And in the process, we traveled all around the world seeking out social movements and civil society groups and even city governments and cities that were exploring how do you really address these root causes of hunger that my mother talked about and talks about in Diet for Small Planet? How do you really address those root causes, and actually how do you try to take on truly ending hunger in your community? And in the process of writing that book, I just had my own kind of epiphany moment of realizing the incredible impact that our U.S.-based food corporations have around the world, the incredible impact our food policies, both domestic and international, have around the world, and felt a real calling to explore ways that I could, in my own work, take on those corporate impacts and those policy impacts to try to help, many, many people all around the world that are trying to help address those root causes of hunger. So that was my moment in my mid-20s.
And did you enjoy the lentils and the tofu and the vegetarian diet when you were growing up? Let's hear, Anna.
I did. I mean, I like to tell people that, you know, yes, I grew up very much the daughter of Frances Moore LePay eating all those lentils. But I also grew up in my dad's house. And so I got all the exposure to things like Lucky Charms and Fruit Loops and all of that. And so I was kind of able a little bit, you know, compare and contrast. But I was able to kind of explore the whole range of eating that most of us, you know, experience. And I really did come around as I entered into my adult life to really enjoy the way of cooking that my mom raised me with, to really realize like just how vibrant and energetic one feels when you're eating healthy food. I'm raising two kids, and I definitely feel like we've been bringing them up with many of the same principles, which are pretty simple. You know, it's basically trying to cook as much as we can from whole foods, not from the supermarket, but from actually whole foods. And really trying to put plants at the center of our plate, really trying to not eat a lot of ultra-processed foods, which puts us, you know, out of line with the typical Americans that are, we're consuming 60% of their calories from ultra-processed foods. So, yes, I definitely embrace the diet for Small Planet Diet.
That's great. Thank you for that. You know, Frankie, you say in your book, quote, in 1970, I never imagined the impact of our diet on the looming life and death climate crisis, nor that 40 years later, my own daughter Anna would tackle this threat in Diet for a Hot Planet, enabling me to learn so much about the climate-food connections. You say that how we feed ourselves worsens climate chaos. Can you expand on that a little bit, Frankie?
Yeah, I think all of us were pretty clueless that long ago about what was ahead in terms of meeting the climate crisis and how agriculture contributes to it. It's estimated that our entire food system contributes about 37% of all greenhouse gas emissions. It could be that high. And something like 40% of that comes from livestock. So that's a real significant piece. And whereas people have estimated, done all sorts of studies of what would happen if we moved to a plant-centered diet, and they describe, for example, that if we move to a plant-centered, not necessarily vegetarian, but heavily plant-centered, that it would reduce greenhouse gas emissions from agriculture by about two-thirds. And that another really interesting estimate is that if we swapped beef for beans, that shift alone could be a big part of meeting our commitment to the Paris Agreement on climate. So there's, and, you know, of course, a part of this is that our rainforest, for example, the Amazon, which is the most important biodiverse region, and rainforest that the destruction of it is very much, 80% of it is driven by beef production, by cattle production, both to graze and to produce feed. And so that's a big part of the climate crisis, is in the way that a meat-centered diet contributes to it, is that it contributes to species decimation and tropical forest destruction.
Yeah, there's so much to that, what you just said. And I'm also so moved that I'm sure Anna was able to, you know, mentor you probably in some of these ways, just as you mentored her in the ways you learned to really think about the power we have to change things, and the situation that we're all in, often feeling hopeless. But the fact is that we have to keep talking about these really difficult things so that we can keep waking up to the solutions. And I that's one of the reasons I really am glad you're here talking with us today. I want to open up the phone lines as well so people can ask questions. You're listening to About Health on KPFA. I'm your host, Rona Renner, and I'm joined today by Frances Moore LePay, author of Diet for a Small Planet, and Anna LePay, author of Diet for a Hot Planet. We're here celebrating the 50th anniversary edition of Diet for a Small Planet and talking about the pressing issues of diet and the health of individuals, communities, and the planet. You can join in the conversation with your questions or comments at 1-800-958-9008. You can also email me at nurserona, N-U-R-S-E-R-O-N-A, at kpfa.org. We would love to hear from you. Anna LePay, in your book, A Diet for a Hot Planet, you say that we are not bystanders. We are players in the story of global warming, and it's happening to us right here, right now, and that we can be a part of transforming the climate change story, again, from this feeling of hopelessness to one of renewal and resilience. One way you say we can be part of the shift is to align ourselves with a sane food system. Now, this was about 6 years ago that you wrote that. Do you still think it's true? And what are the core elements of a sane food system?
Yeah, well, absolutely still true. That part of what can be so so much part of the heartbreak of climate change and the climate crisis is feeling like we have no power. It's so big, it's so vast. What can we possibly do about it? And I feel like one of the storylines about connecting food to climate is a storyline that helps us see about how this very intimate daily choice we make about food can align us with a food system that is more sane, that's better for the planet, better for our bodies, and better for workers. And a lot of those principles are the same principles my mother has been talking about for 50 years. So it's a principled way of eating that, again, centers plants on your plate, because as my mother said, livestock has a really disproportionate impact on climate compared with, say, beans or lentils or vegetables or fruits or nuts. And so plant-centered diets is a really important principle. But we also know beyond that, really looking at how can we support farmers and farmers transitioning to a way of producing food that is not dependent on petrochemicals, that's not dependent on fossil fuels. So I've been really moved over the years by the work of a scientist named Sandra Steingraber, who talks about the branches of the fossil fuel tree. And one of those branches is fertilizers and pesticides. And so how can we make sure that at the same time we're campaigning to electrify our grids and putting solar panels on our homes, we're also looking at all of those various branches that the fossil fuel industry is exploring as escape hatches, and making sure that both our individual choices are reducing the demand for fossil fuels, but also our policies are helping more of us and more food producers shift away from dependence on fossil fuels. So those are some of the ways both we as individuals can make choices, but also we as individuals can use our voices to speak up for elected officials who are really going to stand up for the public interest and not for the fossil fuel industry, whether that's, you know, putting their gas in the tanks of our cars or using fossil fuels to develop synthetic fertilizers or petrochemicals for our farm fields.
Thank you for that. That's, really, really important stuff you're saying. I appreciate that. Let's take a call now. We have Richard with us from Oakland. Hi, Richard. You're on About Health.
Great. Thank you so much for taking my call, a longtime listener. I was very happy to hear some very specific comments regarding how cattle raised impact and other animals, of course, are negatively impacting our global climate change problem. And I just wanted to add a little bit about that. I became an earth science researcher in 1995 at a famous nearby institution, but I don't want to mention their name because I'm speaking as an individual and not for that institution. I've got a few big picture comments to make. First, I want to talk about, there's something called a carbon cycle, and we researchers divide that those many, many different versions of the cycle, just like the water cycle, into a short and a long version. The long cycle involves sequestration in the earth, and is the typical source, or at least we believe, for things like coal and other petroleum products and so forth. The short cycle involves the cycle of, say, atmosphere, plant, ingestion by an herbivore, breakdown by gut bacteria, and potentially release therefrom as methane, or potentially becoming muscle tissue and later released by bacteria at some other point back to the atmosphere. So it's an atmosphere-to-atmosphere trip that goes through some particular path. And as humanity has wiped off the face of the earth, a great herd of, for example, the bison, and have largely replaced with others, I'm glad to have it mentioned and not just said that these cattle are the problem, because the cattle are doing what other animals would do, except with a few particular specifics, one being the fertilizer and the energy put into the raising of grains to feed them with and so forth. But also, very importantly, it's been learned that these farm-raised creatures, in particular cattle, produce more CO2 than than a more natural species. And and it's also been learned that a little bit of seaweed helps get rid of that problem. And I think that that is worthy of some attention. So before I break off, I don't want to like hijack this or anyway.
Right. And your connection is a little iffy here. So I am going to ask you to go ahead, wrap it up, Richard.
Right. And I would just quickly say that, unfortunately, what the worst problems we have are skewed in the numbers, and we researchers can't really tell you the fact that as we researchers really know them, because our research gets edited in our conclusion and in our executive summary.
Okay. Yes. Thank you for that last piece, especially. I think again, what you're saying is a little bit complicated for me. I don't understand a lot of what you said, but I'm going to ask either Anna or Frankie to respond to this, but also, you know, what do we learn and who are we learning this information from? Anna, you want to take it first?
Sure. I mean, I think what comes to mind as I was listening to the comment is that anytime we're talking about food systems and what does it look like to create food systems here in the U.S. and around the world that is actually not going to destabilize the climate, we need to talk about what kind of food is most aligned with climate to produce, but also on what scale and how much. So it is not rational, as my mom has said for many decades, to be producing grain-fed beef at the scale that we are. There is something like 222 pounds of meat produced for every man, woman, child in the United States, you know, way more than we should be consuming. And the average American today is consuming about twice as much protein as their bodies need. And so we're talking about how do we align diets that, again, it's better for our health not to be over-consuming protein, and it's better for our health to be eating more plants, and also that those practices, and again, not just as individuals, but on a society level, incentivizing those kinds of production practices is exactly what we need to be doing to address the climate crisis. And that if we're talking about climate, we have to be putting food systems into that conversation, because as my mother said, 37% of our emissions are coming from food, from how we produce it, how we process it, where we transport it, what we do with the waste. And so climate scientists tell us if we don't address those emissions, that we will blow our carbon budget, even if we get everything else right.
Uh-huh. Yes. I've read those words before, and you saying that, so we need to listen loud and clear. Frankie, did you want to add anything to that?
Well, I wanted to just not directly add more about climate change, but rather, this is the looming fear for all of us of how we are damaging our climate and the consequences for our children and grandchildren. And I just want to stress that right now, for ourselves, for our own health, I learned so much in writing this 50th anniversary opening chapter that we gain so much that, for example, the World Health Organization now says that processed meat is a carcinogen, and 20% of the meat that we eat in the U.S. Is processed, and that red meat in general is a probable carcinogen, and that yet U.S. leads the world in beef consumption overall, and I think we're fourth place per capita. But I just want to underscore how positive it is for us. Yes, let's be concerned and let's do the right thing for our future and the climate, all that. And let's know that we are doing our bodies, our health, our vitality a big favor by moving toward plant-centered, and now I call it plant- and planet-centered eating.
I like that. I like that a lot. And, you know, and your book is really terrific. I noticed that as I was looking through the recipes, I was reminded of, you know, the way I cook. A lot of it is the way I cook. And then there were things that I forgot about. And I even made your recipe, the chickpea mulligatawny. How do you say that? Am I saying it right?
I think
the
so.
The soup. Yeah. Okay, good. Yeah. It's the wonderful soup. It's the wonderful soup with, you know, with chickpeas and coconut milk and onions and carrots. And it was, it's just delicious for a cold day. But it was so good to remind myself of, again, how I do eat a lot like that, and I can do more. And I think people who are regular meat eaters, you know, it doesn't mean you have to go cold turkey. It means you could have a few days a week where you look for good recipes that will be nourishing and satisfying. And that goes along with the question I have from a caller, Frankie. The question from this listener, Matt asks, what is one recipe that you can share that's easy and delicious and also a great substitute for a climate-harming meal, something that can turn a committed meat eater into a believer? So do you have something you want to recommend, Frankie?
Well, there's so many great recipes in here. Anna, I have to give her credit for helping big time. She was the force behind the updating of the recipes, so she would undoubtedly want to jump in here. But certainly one of the things that is really a beautiful dish is the lentil curry with green peas and cauliflower, because it's got you know, beautiful color and veggies in it. And but there are just so many here, and they're organized with main dishes and sauces. So, you know, one of the things is just having a variety of sauces that you can do then creative things with whatever vegetables you happen to have on hand. So, Anna, do you want to weigh in with your favorites here, and also mention the wonderful generosity of the chefs who contributed too?
Sure. Yeah. And like my mom said, I have many favorites. I love them all. So I worked on this section with an incredible recipe developer named Wendy Lopez, who has a website called Food Heaven Made Easy that I highly recommend. And what I loved about working with Wendy is her whole approach to cooking is, how do we keep it simple? How do we make it accessible while also really showcasing the vibrancy and the diversity of plant-centered eating? And I feel like all of the recipes achieve that. But to answer specifically your question about how do you, which recipe would we pitch to you to persuade maybe a meat eater, right? What I'd highly recommend is checking out the veggie burger recipe we have in the book. And I approached a friend, Brooks Headley, who has a restaurant in New York City called Superiority Burger. And he's a James Beard Award-winning chef. He has gotten James Beard Awards for his pastry work. But then he went on to open this restaurant that is an amazing, brilliant showcase of how you can be so creative with vegetarian burgers, or vegan in his case. And what I love about the burger is it's not trying to taste like meat, like some of these products many of the products we now have in the marketplace, these kind of alt meat products. He writes, this is not fake meat, nor is it buying to be. The unlikeness to the real thing is canny. And he goes on to describe all the incredible vegetables in it. But I highly recommend trying Brooks Superiority Burger, or really any of the recipes from the 14 chefs who we asked to contribute some of their favorite recipes to the book.
Great. Thank you. I will definitely try that one out for sure. You're listening to About Health. I'm talking with Frances Moore LePay, and she's the author of Diet for a Small Planet and Anna LePay, Diet for a Hot Planet. Feel free to join us. The phone number is 1-800-958-9008. If you were a fan of this book 50 years ago, let us know how you're doing with it today, if you have any questions for them. I was taking a walk with a friend this morning, and she told me, she said that she was at Stanford, and it was required reading to read A Diet for a Small Planet, but the class was called Man and the Environment. So she said today it probably today it would be called People and the Environment. Yes. The phone number here is 1-800-958-9008. You can also email me at nurserona@kpfa.org. So we have another listener who emailed me, and Maria asks, what can local governments like school districts do to embrace your work? Frankie?
Oh, I think Anna's got to go for that one, right, Anna?
Okay, Anna, you go for it. Yeah.
I could jump in. I mean, one thing immediately that jumps to mind, and there's incredible local policies popping up all around the country, but one that is, I think, really exciting to see spreading is called the Good Food Purchasing Program. Next year is the 10th anniversary of the first school district that passed the program, which was Los Angeles School District. And the idea is to look at all the billions of dollars that our public, the public sector spends on food, particularly for school food. And the folks who developed the policy said, look, currently the kind of default approach to procurement, so what the government is spending on, say, supply chains like food, is to just look at what's the cheapest and then pick that bidder for the school food, for instance. And what organizers in Los Angeles did was say, wait a second, these are our public dollars going to the public good, to the kids in our community. What would it look like to develop a policy that looked through five values lenses to determine what food should we prioritize? So they looked through the lens of health, the environment, animal welfare, worker welfare, local economies, and developed a policy that enables school districts to look through those lenses when they're making their choices for who they're going to bring in to the school district to supply bread and chicken and any number of things that go into school food. So Los Angeles City Council, Los Angeles School Board passed the policy in 2012, and we saw incredible changes in the school food supply chain there. And now many other cities around the country have adopted the program, including San Francisco and Oakland here in the San Francisco Bay Area, Chicago, many other cities. And it's really exciting to see the movements that have been brought together when you actually look at this really holistic values lens around school food and food in general. And that's one example of a policy that I'm really excited about.
So it's called the Good Food Purchasing Program.
Exactly. And everybody can go to goodfoodcities.org to learn more about it.
Yeah, I think Berkeley should definitely have something like that. You know, I remember when my youngest daughter was in school, we tried to bring in salad bars to the school, and it was so exciting to see all these fresh vegetables and fruits there. And at that time, it failed after a while because it required parents to be the ones in charge of it. They didn't have the staff to keep the salad bar neat and clean while the kids were getting their salad. And so over the years, I've seen really good programs, of course, like, you know, gardens in schools and kids learning how to grow food and, you know, wonderful programs that Anna, you were probably involved with back in the day. I know Mara was also. But I don't know what else is happening in the schools. And it seems like that's where parents really need to step up and join these committees to talk about what are our kids eating and how can we make changes. So thank you for that. Anything else you want to add to that, Frankie?
No, that's just, I'm just so thrilled with what Anna's involved in. It's so important.
Yes, and I want to ask you, Frankie, you know, you talked in your books about protein, and I wonder if you can give us some information. There's a lot of confusion, I think, about how much we actually need, and I think in the early days, you really wanted to teach people about, you know, how we can find protein other than in meats, you know, how there is protein in nuts and there's protein in beans and lentils and things like that. Anything else you think we all need to know about that?
Well, what has changed in the understanding of scientists is that we do not have to worry about this idea that was in my first version where I talked about the idea of balancing amino acids by eating foods from various food groups. And I love that idea. I felt like I was a chemist in the kitchen, you know, sort of inventing these great combos. But now we learn, the scientists tell us that if we eat a range of healthy foods, whole foods, we will get enough protein. We do not have to worry. And so we can just relax. And actually, you know, we think, yes, that nuts and legumes, peas, beans, and lentils, that is, they do have they strong percentage of protein, but just about everything we eat in the plant world has a little bit. And so in our appendix, you know, we include a little breakdown so people can see that. So if you're eating a whole range of foods, you are covered. And again, whole foods, if at all possible. Obviously, it's the processed foods that are so unhealthy.
Absolutely. And I think that's the biggest challenge that I know parents face and we all face, is how to, you know, detox in a way from the processed foods and how to make sure we can get beautiful, healthy foods, fruits and vegetables and other wheat and grains and nuts, so that we can feel satisfied and nourished and not have to go to the crackers and other, you know, quick meals that have a lot of salt and sugar and the wrong kinds of fats. So, you know, your work from 50 years ago is continuing as we all trying to figure this out, not to feel shame or guilt, but to just keep every day trying to eat a little bit more healthy. Let's take a call now. We have, I think it's Herc and Elsa Bronte.
Hi.
You're on About Health. Hi.
Hi. Hello. And thank you. Can you hear me? Yeah, your very strategic thinking, combining personal and planetary health. Thank you. Of course, Josh Patel and his co-author also on that path. And inflammation is like overheating, and in both cases, the health crisis is largely inflammation of, you know, various reasons. But I just wanted to point out, lentils, when pressure cooked, they don't cause inflammation because of the lectins. And I'm wondering if you're aware of Dr. Stephen Gundry and the incredible work he's done. The book is called Longevity Paradox. So that's my question.
Yes, I've seen his work. I haven't followed his work. So thank you for bringing that up. There's so many people out there giving us ways to eat. So the longevity is something certainly to look into, Gundry's work. But I think you bring up inflammation and it is a piece of what we all have to keep looking at as to what leads to chronic illness. And I think, you know, Anna, in your work and in your mom's work, you really are looking at ways to reduce inflammation, in a sense, in our personal bodies and also in the planet. I think that's a really interesting analogy. Do you have anything you want to say to Herc and Elsa Bronte?
Well, I can just jump in quickly. Thank you, Herc. You know, you mentioned Raj Patel's work, and he's a dear friend of ours, actually did one of our Diet for a Small Planet book launches with us, and Raj Patel and Dr. Rupa Maurya just published a book called Inflamed that gets to a lot of what Herc was raising. And I think for me, and I think for my mom and me, the part of our message is really intertwined with the Rupa and Raj message, which is that what we experience of the world on this individual level has this direct connection with what's happening on a planetary level, and vice versa. And that sense of interconnectedness is a really vital part of the way we think about the food we eat and the food we think our policymakers should be incentivizing farmers to produce. And that piece of it's really important. So, for instance, when we talk in this new edition about the importance of eating organic food, the importance of, for those of us who can, find food that's grown without toxic pesticides, that's really good for our bodies and for our children's bodies. But really, it's also even more critical because we talk about who is most impacted by pesticides used on our foods. It's the farm workers and farmers who are in direct contact with the pesticides. It's agricultural communities who live alongside fields where these pesticides are used. And then even broaden that out, it is understanding that pesticides are a petrochemical and are connected and deeply implicated in climate as well. So I think that's what I heard in her question touches on a way that my mother and I think about these stories we tell about food, that while food can feel so personal and it's so intimate, of course, it reverberates out across communities and indeed around the world and as big as climate too.
Absolutely. And, you know, glyphosate use is restricted in over 40 countries and also banned in many. So let me ask you, Frankie, do you have any sense of why it's still not banned here?
Well, it has everything to do with the quality of our democracy, that there are 20 lobbyists for every single person you and I elect to represent us in Washington, and there are more agribusiness lobbyists than there are oil and gas lobbyists. So there is a great deal of pressure put on not to ban things that enable corporations to make huge sums of money by their monopoly control. Agribusiness suffers tremendous concentration of power that limits its, that strengthens its power over our health. That in virtually every piece of the food system, there are just four or so companies that control the huge share of the market. So I think that's really an answer to the question that we have to be both food activists and democracy activists and make sure that we are working for a system that does not allow private interest to overwhelm our health.
Yep. That's so true, and there are so many people who suffer from the poisoning. You know, the farmers, or they're poisoned by pesticides every year, and there's still not the labor protections that are needed, and also our children, and we are suffering when we eat products that have glyphosate in them, and it's just such a shame that still is going on. But let me take another call. We have Helen waiting. Hi, Helen. You're on About Health.
Hi. Thank you so much for this wonderful conversation. It's fantastic. And I'm just thrilled to hear you guys. I bought the book, A Diet for a Small Planet, all those years ago, and read it very, very, very thoroughly all that time ago, and I loved it. I'm so glad it's coming out again. And I love the other book, Diet for a Hot Planet, and the idea of what you said, the climate crisis at the end of your fork. And it's just, I'm so happy to hear you guys. And I'm currently a vegan, and it's so easy to eat. I just eat through the food groups. There's vegetables, fruits, nuts, grains, legumes, and a little bit of omega-3 fat and olive oil. And that's it. And it's so easy to eat. It's easier than anything I've ever eaten before. And I'm in perfect health. I'm 63. So I'm roaring to go for the next 30 years. And I just want to say two thumbs up to both of you guys and keep up the good work.
Oh, that's really nice, Helen. Frankie, would you like to respond?
Oh, I have the biggest smile on my face. So that's just so great, because that's really what our message is. It's a message of celebration, not a finger pointing. It's really embracing what is best for our bodies and the earth, and how it's satisfying that is on every level. And I felt when I moved from a cow town diet that I grew up on to a plant-centered diet, I felt like that caller sounds, where I stopped obsessing about calorie counting. I started just enjoying food and never having to worry about restriction, but just enjoyment. That was it.
Enjoyment. That's really good. Well, I'm just wondering what you learned during the process of putting together this 50th anniversary edition. again, we talked a little bit about some changes regarding protein. It seems like you addressed the climate crisis more. Anything else, Frankie, that that you feel like you really learned or had to change in this new edition?
Well, I think I was shocked by the fact that now, as Anna pointed out, 60% of our calories come from products, not even food, truly. They're products that give us no nutrition. And I think that's heavily connected to this terrifying real finding that just sinking in for me, that almost half of us now in America are either pre-diabetic or diabetic. And that is such a burden. And, you know, people have written to us who've said, oh, I moved to a plant-centered diet and my diabetes, you know, disappeared. And so that I think is a health crisis that we can't overrate, you know, it's a health crisis. And that we don't typically think of plant-centered diet as a solution, but clearly it is helping people. And I'm just so wanting to call that out for people who have that problem, because it's so widespread and so, you know, so debilitating.
So debilitating, and drains our economy, but also drains families and resources and quality of life. And again, I don't blame people if they, you know, have processed foods, because it's been such a campaign over the years to to encourage people to eat and live that way. So we need people like you both who are encouraging people in a different direction. I wonder, Anna, in terms of whether there were big changes that were made in the recipe section. One thing I noticed was that the original book had margarine and now we have butter. Anything else? Anything else major that you noticed?
Yeah, that was definitely one. I did a search for all the mentions of margarine and took it all out and replaced it with butter. The same for, and this probably wouldn't surprise you either, Rona, but the same for the indication to look, say, for low-fat milk or low-fat yogurt. We replaced all of that with whole-fat milk products, for instance, for recipes that called for it. And then we also, as my mother already mentioned, we took out all of the suggestions about that idea of complementary proteins, which, again, was the science in the early 70s that my mother has revised over the years, which is, again, underscoring that as long as you're eating this really diverse plant-centered diet, none of us really have to sweat how much protein we're getting. So we really wanted to really help people who are reading the book feel completely emboldened that if you're eating this diet, you'll get the nutrients and nutrition you need. And then I think the other thing that we really stressed in the opening to the new recipes was touches on something you were just saying, Rona, about how hard it is for so many of us to make choices about what we eat because of the constraints of our lives. So, for instance, so many of us live in food environments where it's really hard to find fresh fruits and vegetables, for instance, and that so many of us, say, compared to when my mother was writing her original book in the early 70s, so many of us have to work so many more hours. And as working parents, we have actually less time than we used to cook. And so we really don't want anyone to feel any sense, as you put it, Rona, of like shame or judgment for those who are not able to cook and eat in the ways that they might like to. And that actually, that's why we always conjoin these messages of what can we do as individuals with what we can do as citizens to speak up with a collective voice to say, look, an 8-hour workday is a food justice issue. You know, affordable housing is a food justice issue, because if you're putting all of your money into your rent, you won't have any left over to pay for your food. So really trying to see that these calls for changing our food system are deeply interconnected with so much of our society, and that we really want to have those conversations together.
That's really beautifully put. Thank you, Anna. Let's take a call. Marie Louie from Palo Alto. We have just a couple of minutes here left. What would you like to ask?
I'll speak fast. One of the things I want to say is that when I came to this country many years ago, I was shocked at the amount of sugar that is used in so many things. And in fact, I can't walk past an ice cream store without nearly gagging because I smell the sugar from the waffle cones and whatever else. Anyway, so I really think we need to think about that. And we're using up a lot of land to grow sugar beets and maybe sugar cane as well. That could be used much better with real food. So that's,
absolutely.
That's
yes.
Yeah. Thank you.
Yes. Thank you. No, I think that's great. I think we'll stop there because I have another question before we end for our guests. But thank you for that. I think we can't stress that enough, Marie-Louise, that sugar has has seduced many of us, and it's put in everything, and it really needs to, we need to get a handle on that. And for everyone's health, we must get a handle on that. Let me end here by asking both of you to say something about hope. You know, Frankie, you talk about what you call honest hope. That's not blind optimism. Can you say something about that as we are winding down here?
Thank you. Yes. I believe that human beings, we have to be able to see a possibility. We don't have to have certainty. We don't have to have, you know, be optimistic about the outcome. We just have to see that it's possible that if we make different choices, that we can be better and that the planet can do better. So I call myself, my kind of hope is possibilism, that it's not possible to know what's possible because everything is changing and everything is related. But we do know that as we make our individual choices, it is possible that we will become powerful enough to feel that we can make the system changes that are necessary. So I that's the kind of hope that keeps me going. It's just a sense of possibility is all human beings need. And I think clearly every day people are showing us what's possible.
Thank you for that. And I just want to say my, you know, sincere gratitude to all of the work you've done. And I know there's more to come. So thank you so much, Frances Moore LePay. And Anna LePay, talk about hope the last minute here.
Thanks for the question. And I began by talking about the book that I wrote with my mother that set me on my lifelong journey. And that book is called Hope's Edge. And it's called that because we wanted to share this insight that we came to in writing the book about hope and where we think it comes from. And before I wrote that book, I think I had a really a sense that hope was only for those who didn't have a sense of how bad things were and realizing how hope can come and has to come from taking action. So that's where I get my hope, that it is through action that we can tap into and discover hope.
Thank you so much. And I want to suggest people go to smallplanet.org and realfoodmedia.org so you can learn more. My gratitude to my guests, to all of you, our listeners, to Rod Akhil, the engineer at the controls. I'm your host, Rona Renna. I'll be back in 2 weeks. If you missed any part of the show, go to nurserona.com. May you be healthy, happy, and live with peace and ease as best you can. And do try some of the recipes in a diet for a small planet. They're yummy, and they also help our planet.
You're tuned in to KPFA, listener-sponsored non-commercial radio streaming at kpfa.org. The election for the local station board is currently underway, with 21 listener candidates running for 9 spots on the local station board. This is an announcement from one of them, Fred Dodsworth.
Hello, my name is Fred Dodsworth. I'm on the Berkeley Citizens Action Steering Committee. I'm a member of BTU, Berkeley Tenant Union. I work with tenants together, Casa Unidas, and anti-racism groups. I am a 30-year journalist. I believe that it is critical that we give our news programs the freedom to do the work that they have to do. I've watched Pacifica flounder for more than 20 years. 20 years ago, I wrote an article about this problem. I'm joining now to seek find a solution.
To learn more about the local station board candidates or to fill out a form to request or reset your ballot, visit elections.pacifica.org. All ballots are due on Friday, October 15th. Make your voice heard.
Reverend Al Sharpton is one of America's most renowned civil rights leaders. With over 40 years' experience as a community leader, politician, and minister, KPFA with Marcus Books will present Reverend Al, who will discuss his timely new book, Rise Up, Confronting a Country at a Crossroads. Michael Eric Dyson says this man is a gift from God to the world. His book is a gift from Al Sharpton to us. Let's appreciate them both. Reverend Sharpton will be in a KPFA Zoom event on Thursday, October 21st, starting at 7 p.m. Pacific Time. Greg Bridges, hip-hop and social affairs veteran, will host this exceptional event. For tickets, just go to kpfa.org and scroll down.
You're listening to 94.1 KPFA and 89.3 KPFB in Berkeley, 88.1 KFCF in Fresno, 97.5 K248BR in Santa Cruz, and online worldwide at kpfa.org.